We are a nation under God, and I believe God intended for us to be free. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David. Their lives ended in places called Bellow Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. They add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom.
This morning, we recognize that tomorrow is Memorial Day, a day where we honor and give thanks for those who are fallen for the sake of our country, paid the highest price for our national freedom here in America. We are thankful for those who gave their life, who served our country, and paid the price and did not come home. And we are always to be thankful over the years and continue to be thankful for years to come for those who laid down such a sacrifice for us. Giving thanks this morning and recognizing through a couple of videos and a prayer is the very least we can do, but we will at least do that. So would you join me now in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, the time we have to worship you here in this building, in this church. And Lord, we are torn because we are so thankful for the country that we live in, the freedom that we enjoy, the blessings that are unlike any other place in the world. While we say, oh, thank you for that freedom, we recognize, Lord, that it came at the price of men and women who've laid down their life through many, many years of service to this country and will continue to do so. And that is not something we should treat lightly, but instead soberly, seriously, reverently. And it's in that sacrifice, Lord, that we say thank you to those men and women, but we are also reflectant to you, who also laid down a son for our spiritual freedom. And so while we say thank you on a Sunday morning worship service to the men and women who died for our freedom, we also say thank you to a father who laid his son for our spiritual freedom, gave his son for our spiritual freedom. And it's because of that, Lord, that we worship you and we pray to you and we ask you to help us to live a life worthy of that freedom. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. And I pray this in the precious name of that Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen and amen.
Let's sing. I will call upon his name because he is worthy. Thank you, Pastor Brian. Let's sing about that fact that our God is worthy to be praised this morning. See you. and to praise the awesome name of Jesus.
Let's continue to do that.
There's an endless song waiting to be sung with the voice of every tribe, the sound of every tongue. When the bride of Christ on the day of days brings with joy unto the Lamb a multitude of
At this time, I would like to ask our graduating seniors, class of 2024, you know who you are, if y'all will start making your way up to one of some of these front pews, and then we're going to talk about what's going on next. So this morning, we are also presenting Bibles to our graduates who just got done graduating over this past week. Isn't that so cool? Amen. Y'all come on down, have a seat. So you, church, have had the opportunity over the past couple of weeks to go out to these tables. For the past few years, we have been gifting Bibles to our graduates because we believe there's no greater gift you could give a graduate than the Word of God. Amen? And it is something that you, church, I'm so proud of you guys as a church. You are always
so ready to just fill these Bibles with messages, and I've been poking through them over the past week, and just with, I see there's tabs, there's note cards, there's highlighted verses, just so much goodness and just encouragement. And so thank you, just from the bottom of my heart, for just loving on these seniors, whether you knew them personally or not. And so seniors, you are about to be handed Bibles. What we're going to do is we're going to call you up one at a time. And I want to, when we hand you these Bibles, they have a lot of loose materials in them. So make sure, you know, you're being careful with them. Because like I mentioned, there's like note cards and all that stuff in a lot of these Bibles. And so there's a lot that has been kind of stuffed in there. And that's all good stuff. And it's all amazing things that the church has done a wonderful job of just getting messages to you. But I just want to kind of just one quick just thought for you guys. The Word of God is the lamp to our feet and the light into our path. And I know no matter if you're a high school graduate or if you're an adult, and like no matter where you are at stage in life, that truth never changes. And so our prayer, graduates, is that this copy of God's Word, and that you cling to it, you memorize it, you study it, you just read it, cherish it, and know that we as a church cherish you. And we love you, and we're constantly praying for you and supporting you, no matter where the Lord may lead you. Amen, church? Amen. So, hey, at this time, so as we call you up one by one, we'll hand you your Bible, and then we will start lining you up, starting at this little handrail this way. And then church, kind of give you a heads up. After that, we will then have a time of prayer for these graduates. At that time, after we get done, we'll call you guys up to put your hand on the shoulder of one of these graduates, and then we will have kind of a group time of prayer after that, okay? So just keep that in your mind. So number one, who we have first, is Mr. Logan Cruz-Turner. Come on down. Give him a round of applause. You can go. You can do that. Thank you, brother. Next one, we got Jacob Dowling. Jacob. Miss Maddie Downs. Is it Clay Geisler? Micah Givens. Cameron Kellis. Gracie Knight. Is Landon McIntyre. Miss Kinsey Norton. Miss Jayla Session. Miss Joe Roby. And then last, but definitely not least, Miss Destiny Stark. Hey, one, let's see. Do we... Okay, gotcha. All righty. So with that, we have a few more that we want to announce. They weren't able to be here this morning, so we're going to have them on the screen. First up is Eli Adair. He's going to be going straight into the work to the workforce while also taking some college classes. Miss Sarah Boudreaux. Sarah is going to be going to SFA for nursing for the BSN. Then we have Matthew Babel. He's also going to be going to Colorado Christian University as a recipient of the Presidential Academic Scholarship, studying outdoor leadership under a business degree. And then, of course, then also Miss Gracie Threadgill, who will be going to TJC and majoring in sonography. So we have a lot of wonderful seniors, a great group. We just love them just so, so very much. And so at this time, we're going to ask you, church, if y'all will begin to make your way down to then put your hand on the shoulder of one of these seniors as we get ready for this time of prayer. Thank you. church. Can I have one of our church members to volunteer to start us off, and then I will be the caboose here at the end to pray after we open up in prayer, as you feel led, pray out loud for this wonderful group, and then after a moment of silence, I will close at the end. We have someone that will volunteer to start us off this morning. Pastor Brian, thank you, brother. All right, Pastor Brian's going to start us off, and then after he gets done, as you feel led, please feel free to pray for this group.
God, has been a blessing just to see you move in their lives, and Lord, it is such an exciting time, and Lord, I lift them up to you, God. I pray, God, that you just continually lead them, that they would have their eyes fixated on you. Lord, I pray, God, they would just be led by your word, by your Holy Spirit. God, and even in the days ahead where there might be uncertainties or there might be roadblocks in the road, God, may they trust in your plan for their life. Lord, as Proverbs 16:9 says, as we can make all the plans we want, but Lord, you ultimately direct our steps. May we just trust in you with all of our heart. God, I pray that they would not lean on their own understanding, but in all ways acknowledge you. and that you would make their paths straight. And God, I pray that not just for them, but also for their parents. God, this is not just a big change in their lives, but also a big change in the lives of their parents. And some of them that might end up being empty nesters. God, I pray that you would minister to them, you would minister to their families. God, that there would be a smooth transition. God, that they would be able to get their feet underneath them. Lord, we just pray that you would bless these graduates. Lord, as a church, God, help us to continue to pray for them, continue to encourage them. And Lord, may we always just be in their corner. God, we thank you just so much for just the testimony of the work that you have done in the lives of these students. And we are so thankful for what you have in store for them. And Lord, we are so excited for just the plan that you have for them. And God, we entrust them to you. And Lord, we just pray, God, that we would trust you in all things. And we love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said.
Let's stand together as we continue to sing praises to the Lord. give him the praise for what he's done. And the glorious thing about it is not what he has done but what in our lives, but what he will do. He has already fought the battle for you and for me. This is the declaration for our seniors as you go out into the world right here.
There's peace that outlasts darkness and hope that's in the blood. There's future grace that's kind today.
Here it is.
That Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands. All I need.
Amen. You may be seated, church. Kids, I believe it's time for kids' worship.
Amen. Amen. Thank you to our music team and our AV team, as always, for the music this morning and the beautiful truths that we sang. Jaden, I really like that song you sang. I think it was the boots, though. Got to be honest. The boots are awesome. Thank you so much. Amen. Well, if you have your Bible, open it to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We'll be looking at verses 17 through 20 and closing out chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians. As these students bid farewell to high school, they close the chapter of their lives. I want to encourage them to be sure that it is only to high school they bid farewell. That it is only to the school, to that part of their education that they leave behind. So often, graduation is not only when students say goodbye to high school, but also to the church. As they go off to college or to the workforce or to the military, they no longer feel as though church has anything to offer them. We all likely know someone who once took a very active part in a youth group at the local church, but once they graduated, they just stopped going. And sometimes it starts even before then, they say, when they get their driver's license. But there's all kinds of studies out there, and they show, you know, anywhere from 60 to 80% of those who graduate from high school leave the church. Maybe they come back years later, but that shouldn't be the case. Everyone should always understand that they are a welcome part of the body of Christ. And it's not just to high school students that this is true. We all likely know someone, if not in high school, at some point in their life, they were a part of the local church, but now they have nothing to do with it. Either because they were hurt, or they had some negative experience, or perhaps they just don't see the point of making time for the church. For many, church is just a place that they go to or don't go to on Sunday mornings. But that's never been God's intentions for the church. He did not send His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross so we would go to church once a week. The church was never meant to be just a meeting place where we sing songs, a weekly family tradition, or just a social gathering place. The point of the church, it's not to pay the bills, it's not to pay the staff, it's not to keep the piano and the guitars tuned up. The point of the church is to be a holy nation, a chosen people, a royal priesthood, the Apostle Peter calls us, that would shine like stars for all the world to see. And in that, a place of community, a place of family affection, a place of belonging. And that is something you never graduate from, something you never retire from, something you never grow to a point you no longer have a need for. Unfortunately, many times the church portrays something of an opposite picture. Often we are portrayed as a disjointed people, full of infighting, bickering against one another, unable to agree, or perhaps too lazy to do anything or share the gospel with the lost world. Are we so distracted by our own lives, we forget the vast riches we have in Christ Jesus and forget that the church, the family of God, is a part of that vast, rich heritage we have in Christ Jesus. Paul did not want the church in Thessalonica to forget the bond that they had. Despite the enemies attacking them, despite the enemies attacking him, he reminds them in these next four verses of these three realities that depicted his relationship within the church of Thessalonica and the church itself and their relationship with one another and church even today. These three realities are true of us. First, let's read our text, verses 17 through 20. 1 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verses 17 through 20. But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at His coming? Is it not you? Verse 20, for you are our glory and joy. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for all that it has to teach us and to show us and to confront us with in our life. And I pray, as only you are able, you would grow us, show us, teach us, mature us. Pray your Holy Spirit would have His way with each and every heart in this place this morning. And I pray this in the name of your Son and my Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In 1992, author Stephen Ambrose released a book entitled Band of Brothers. It was about the Army's Easy Company during World War II. They were a parachute infantry division. And the book covers the Easy Company from their initial training in 1942 to the end of the war, including their parachuting into Normandy on D-Day, the Battle of the Bulge, and Operation Overlord. Now, you probably know this title from HBO, and they eventually adapted Ambrose's book into a miniseries by the same title. But that title, Band of Brothers, comes from a speech from Shakespeare's Henry V, in which King Henry is speaking to his troops who are about to go into battle but are vastly outnumbered by the enemy. And he's got a long speech. I'm not going to read it all. It's Shakespeare. But this is the line that this title comes from. He says to his troops, "We in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. For he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother." You see, even the world recognizes the bond that occurs amongst those who go through struggle together. Even the world, apart from Christ, recognizes there is a band, a togetherness, a bond that is created from those who go through battle together. There's a brotherhood, a sisterhood, a family connection and affection that comes from fighting the good fight with each other. Church, we're called to be in the trenches together. We are called to recognize that this church thing is not about a building, it's not about programs, or about meeting our individual needs, but individuals banded together, meeting the needs of the whole to the glory of God. I need you, church, and you need me. We need one another. And with that, I've got three realities from this scripture I want to go through. I'm going to leave a lot of meat on the bone. I want to invite you to come tonight to the deep dive. I'll get the rest of that meat. Reality number one, a courageous affection. There is a courageous affection that is in the church. Verse 17 had some of the most affectionate words in it in the Bible. He says, "We were torn away from you. We endeavored eagerly with great desire to see you face to face." If this letter were not addressed from the Apostle Paul to the church in Thessalonica as a whole, we might think that a soldier was writing his long-lost love, his special someone back home. But that's the point of all this. This is the affection Paul feels towards this church. The word "torn away" in the original language was used in this culture to speak of a child who had been orphaned or a spouse who had been bereaved of her loved one. It's an emotional word. It's a gut-wrenching word. Torn away from you, he says. The language Paul uses towards the Thessalonians might not fly nowadays in 2024, But it is the kind of affection I believe we need within the church. This is the affection that develops in the foxhole. It is the sacrificial affection. I will lay down my life for you because you are my brother of another mother and my sister of another mister. This is God's love. It's a strong love, an immovable love. On our own, we're unable to love one another like this. But Christ pours His love into us through the Holy Spirit, Romans 5:5, and we can love like He loves, like Paul loves. And this church is the love that should exude out of our very essence amongst us as a people. Talentedness and giftedness is good, but it is no substitute for love for God and love for people. You can go to a church that has talented preachers and teachers and musicians, but that does not necessarily mean they love the Lord, and out of that love, they love people. Biblical history reminds us of the stories of leaders like Saul. He was a wonderful king. He was handsome and tall, and everybody loved him, and the kingdom of Israel was united under his leadership. A talented leader, but he did not love the Lord. He was not devoted to the Lord. He had no courageous affection, as was shown by how he tried to kill King David as he was threatened by him. Or how about Judas? He was probably a very likable and talented guy, one of the 12 disciples, voted to keep track of the disciples' finances, probably voted most likely to succeed. Yet we know he did not love the Lord. Talent is great. Love is better. There are no perfect churches. There are no perfect pastors, no perfect ministers. There is only a perfect Savior. In a church that exalts Jesus and strives to love Jesus and show the love of Jesus is a church that will love you with a courageous affection. It's courageous because it's not easy. It's courageous because it extends beyond ourselves, beyond our comfort zones to affect another person. Find a church that loves beyond a human ability and that will miss you when you are gone and long to see you again face to face. This is a reality we need in our lives, in our relationship with the Lord, an affection that is courageous because it is birthed in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Reality number two, we have a potent enemy. A potent enemy. Why didn't Paul go back to the Thessalonians, he says in verse 18? He wanted to, again and again, but he was hindered by Satan. And that word hindered is actually a military term. It has a picture of an enemy digging a trench or tearing up a road to keep the other's troops from moving forward or reaching its men or supplies. John MacArthur writes in his commentary, one of the countermeasures an ancient army would take against the opposition was to dig a massive trench that would prevent enemy troops from reaching its men. Now, not everything can or should be blamed on Satan, but we need to recognize that all of humanity has a common enemy, Satan. And he wants to steal, kill, and destroy humanity. And will go to great lengths to do so. Paul says, I was hindered by Satan. Satan dug a trench so I couldn't get to you. He tore up the road so I couldn't get to you. You know what? Satan is going to do everything he can to hinder you from being a part of the family of God. He's going to make you feel like you don't belong. He's going to say you don't fit in there. He's going to say they don't really care about you. But I'm going to tell you, find a church that loves you affectionately, courageously, and Satan will do everything, throw up every roadblock he can to keep you from there, because when you're all alone, that's when you're most vulnerable. Don't give in. Don't believe the lie. Keep pressing on. Keep a part of a church family, because the enemy, who is potent, wants to get at you. Paul recognized that. And I wonder, will we? I wonder, will we? You know, those excuses that we use to keep us from the church are just that. They're excuses. My dad had a funny statement about excuses I can't say in the church. But just understand that those excuses are really just another word for Satan, the enemy. You know, sometimes it's not easy to recognize Satan. Paul says this about Satan over in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. He says, "For such men are false prophets, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it is no surprise if his servants also disguise them as servants of righteousness." The point being, we won't recognize, that's how potent the enemy is we won't even recognize it's him trying to keep us away from the family of God. It is said that one of the greatest deceits Satan has ever carried out is not the deceit that God does not exist, but that he himself does not exist. But he does exist. And his acts serve to give us doubt, to deter us from our relationship with God, to deter us from our relationship with one another. The Bible says his goal is to destroy humanity, and he prowls around like a lion looking for someone to devour. You know, when the military recognizes the potency of an enemy, what does it do? It rallies together, and it follows the battle plan of its commander. It holds the line with arms linked together. And I pray that the reality that we have a potent enemy would motivate us to draw up in arms with our brothers and sisters in Christ and hold the line together. Hold the line with our commander and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, because we have a very real and present danger in this potent enemy, the devil. Joe Page was a pitcher for the New York Yankees. He said he had a dream one night that he was in heaven, and God asked him to put together a baseball team to play against the devil's team. No miracles, just straight baseball. Joe knew they were going to win because all the greatest ball players were in heaven. But before the game, the devil called Joe up and asked him if he wanted to bet on the game. And Joe said, "We've got all the best players in history, so that wouldn't be a fair bet." The devil said, "Well, I'm certain my team will win the game." Joe said, "What makes you so certain?" And the devil said, "We've got all the umpires." That's funny. I read that somewhere else. I didn't come up with that. That's a true story. But the truth is, the devil is a cheater, but he's also the all-time loser, and he always will be. He is not omnipotent. He is not omniscient. Only God is all-powerful and all-knowing. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. We need to understand we have a potent enemy. But we can rejoice because of our God. We have this third reality, an anticipated victory. We have an anticipated victory. Yeah, we might lose some battles. We might lose some matches from time to time. But in the end, we have the victory in Christ Jesus. And that victory is fulfilled in the glorious return of our champion and Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul says, "What is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at His coming?" He's looking forward to the coming. As I've told you in the book of Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians, Christ's return, the hope of His return is mentioned in every chapter. And here it is again. And Paul sees this as his sure victory. And church, we have a part in this victory. We can sing like that last song that we have a victory, but only if we have it in Christ Jesus. The only way to assure yourself of the victory that we sang about, that the Bible talks about, is if you are in Christ Jesus. And how do you become in Christ Jesus? It's very simple. Admit to God that you are a sinner. We're all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. We've got to come to a point where we admit that. And it's not that God doesn't know it. He knows it. We're not admitting it to Him. We're admitting it to ourselves. I'm a sinner separated from God for all of eternity because I'm a sinner. I've got a sin problem. A, admit. B is believe. Believe that God did something about that sin problem when He sent Jesus Christ to be our Lord and Savior. When He died on the cross, when He was buried in the tomb, when He raised from the tomb on the third day. And the Bible says that all those who believe in Him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. We've got to admit that we've got a sin problem. We've got to believe that God did something about that sin problem in His Son, through His Son, Jesus Christ. And then the Bible teaches us that we've got to confess Jesus as our Savior and Lord. And it goes on to say, all those who call upon the name of Jesus will be saved. That's how you become a part of Jesus Christ. That's how you have a share in the great victory we look forward to when Jesus returns, when Jesus comes back. But Paul moves on and he asks this in verse 9. He says, what do you think will be my joy? What will be my crown? What will be my glory when Jesus comes back? Now, in a victory, in a big victory anyway, when a team wins a championship, what do? They celebrate, but they raise up a trophy, don't they? And this is our prize. This is what we've been looking forward to. This is what we hold up in glory in. This is the trophy. Paul's saying, what will be my trophy? What will I thrust into the air when Jesus comes? And he says, you, church, you are my trophy. You are what brings me joy. You are my Stephanos, my crown. You are what I glory in. Our victory is made complete in Christ's return, but our joy and our glory and our trophy in that return will be what we did in and with that victory in Christ Jesus. You see, we've been given something wonderful and great. We've been given a great opportunity. And the question is what will we do with that opportunity? It's like the parable of the talents that Jesus tells in Matthew 25. Write that down, Matthew 25. And in that parable, there's three servants that are given talents by the master. Two of them do something with the talents. They produce something with the talents. But the third one does nothing. He buries it in the sand. And the one that had nothing or did nothing with that had nothing to rejoice in, nothing to glory in when the master returned. Yes, our victory is in Christ. Yes, we will rejoice in the reception of our eternal life in heaven, but what will he see that we have done in what he has given us? John Stott says this about the Apostle Paul, his joy in this world and his glory in the next are tied up with the Thessalonians, whom Christ, through the apostles' ministry, has transformed. What or whom will our joy and glory be in? The Bible explicitly teaches that there will be a great accounting by God of all His people with the opportunities He has given them. Did we use what He gave us to proclaim His good news? Did we bear fruit? Or did we sit around and feel sorry for ourselves? Play the victim, when really and truly we are the victor in Christ Jesus. Luke 12:48. The second half of the verse says, for everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Now I memorized that. I had to read that because I memorized that differently. To whom much is given, much will be required. We've been given so much. Not just in this nation. This freedom that we enjoy here in America, the opportunities that we have, we're going to be held accountable someday with all of that. But also in Christ Jesus, where we've had the greatest freedom, the greatest opportunity, the greatest victory. I've never held up a state championship trophy. I've never held up a national championship trophy. But one day when Christ returns, I'll have, praise the Lord, many other types of trophies to hold up and say, I didn't do much with this life, but here's what I did, King Jesus. Praise you. Praise you. What will your trophy be? What will your crown, your Stephanos be? What will your joy and glory be in? D.L. Moody is credited with this statement. It's one of my favorite quotes. Our greatest fear should not be a failure, but of succeeding at something that doesn't really matter. Let me read that again. Make sure you hear this. Our greatest fear should not be of failure. Couldn't agree more. We're going to fail. But of succeeding at something that doesn't really matter. As I close, I want to give you a question to ask yourself. In fact, maybe write this question down so you can really think about it and answer it honestly later. Are you ready? Here's the question. It's very simple. What is the one goal of your life? And there's a lot of ways we can ask that question. What is the one goal of your life? And I pray you'd go home and think about it and pray about it. And then imagine Jesus comes back tomorrow or next week. I mean, he could come back any moment. In fact, he could come back right... Oh, dang, I was hoping he'd come back right now. We have to ask ourselves, number one, are we ready for his return? Because when he returns, he's going to take home his people, all those who have trusted in him. Are you ready for that? That's the first question. But the second question Paul is asking here is, what will be my joy? What will be my glory? What will be my crown? What will I be able to show him I have done with the life and opportunity that he has given me? When he comes back, what do we want to present to him as the joy and glory of our life? What do we want to show him that we've done with all the talent and opportunity that we've been given, that he has given us? I pray all of us, not just our high school graduates, but all of us would want to present to him people we have loved and witnessed to and shared the gospel with. People we have grown with and grown in their relationship with him. People we have fished for and made into disciples of him. I pray that your life would matter for him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your goodness and grace and mercy on our life. I thank you, Lord, that we do have a victory in Jesus Christ and that everyone can experience this victory if they simply surrender their life to you as Savior and Lord. Father, I also thank you that you give us so many opportunities and talents and just grace to do for you and for your glory. And I pray, Lord, we would see how precious time is while we're here on earth, that we not waste it striving for things that don't matter, but instead, Lord, we would surrender our life to you and for that which matters most, your glory, the exalting of your name. I thank you that you love us so much. And I pray those who are here this morning would experience that great love and mercy in your name, in your Son. And I pray all this in the precious and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you stand with us? We'll have a time of response. You respond to the Lord as he is leading you during this time as we sing. This altar is open if you'd like to come and pray.
We bow our hearts. Bend our knees, oh Spirit, come make us whole. We turn our eyes from evil things, oh Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face. Oh God, Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face. Oh God, of Jacob.
Amen. Church, you may be seated.
Boy, everybody's ready. I thought y'all'd be singing. All right. Well, hey, it's good to end the service up here. We praise the Lord for the decision of these two young men who've surrendered their life to Jesus as Savior and Lord. When we baptize at this church, we like to make sure everybody understands baptism is not a part of salvation, but baptism is a picture of the salvation that one has already experienced by surrendering their life to Jesus as Savior and Lord. We have two candidates this morning. The first one is Rhett Newman. Come on down, Rhett. You're tall enough. We were wondering if you would be. There you go, buddy. Doing good, doing good. You're all right. You ready? Okay, remember I'm going to ask those two questions. Rhett, have you asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
I love it. Yes, sir. That's good. And you understand baptism doesn't save you, but Jesus saves you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, he says again. Then I get the honor and the privilege of baptizing you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We are buried with him in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. All right. And then we got Tripp Newman. Cousins. Love it. Amen. Thank you so much. Thankful for your families and everybody who's poured into y'all's life. You know, this is a fruit of the children's ministry and all those who have worked with our kiddos and their moms and their grandpas and dads and granddads and grandmas and everybody who's had a part in their life. We thank you for both Tripp and Rhett's decision. All right, Tripp, you ready? I'm going to ask you those two questions. Have you asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
He says yes, sir, too. And then you understand baptism doesn't save you, but Jesus saves you. He says, yes, sir, to that as well. Then it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We are buried with him in baptism, and we're raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. Amen. Church, I pray the Lord blesses you this day. I believe Scott is going to close us out.
Let us pray. Blessed are those that have mourned, for they shall be comforted. Almighty God, lift the hearts of the ones that are here today, who see tomorrow not as a joyous celebration, but as a painful reminder of sorrow and loss. Give strength to those who have lost family. Comfort those who have loved ones died serving their country. Our country. With a thankful heart, let us remember their sacrifice. Let us cherish, nurture, and handle with care the freedom for which they have fought and died. In Christ's name, amen.